Okay, so I'd like to begin by thanking the organizers for inviting me here. So my talk today is based on this paper that I wrote with three graduate students at HRI, Sitender, Sapnamoyan, Mrityunjayan, all of whom should be in the audience. So let me begin by giving a brief motivation for this talk. Okay. And the motivation comes from the observation that string landscape tells us that in string theory, we have many Minkowski, ADS and De Sitter vacua. Okay, so a Minkowski vacua has zero vacuum energy density, De Sitter has positive vacuum energy density and ADS has negative vacuum energy density. Okay. Now, we also know that our universe is undergoing an accelerated expansion, which means that we are living in a De Sitter vacuum. Okay. And this leads to a somewhat inevitable conclusion that our vacuum is metastable. Now, in a metastable vacuum, there is a certain probability per unit time, per unit volume of producing a microscopic bubble of more stable vacuum. Okay. And once such a bubble is formed, the wall expands with speed that approaches the speed of light and eventually it engulfs everything that comes within its reach. So I'll denote by k the probability of producing a bubble per unit time per unit volume. This number k can in principle be calculated from the microscopic theory if we know it, but since we do not know where we are in the landscape of vacua in string theory, at present we cannot calculate k. Okay. So this k will appear as a parameter in this talk. Now the fact that we have survived for the age of the universe, which is about 14 billion years, that suggests indirectly that our half-life is at least of order 10 to the 10 years. Okay. And this means, for example, that a chance of our being engulfed by such a bubble during the next year could be as large as 1 in 10 to the 10. And we'll see that this number, in fact, is 3 times bigger, okay, for reasons that I'll try to explain during the talk. Okay. And the question that we'll try to address is, what can we do about this? Okay, so let me begin by giving a brief description of how we study vacuum decay in a metastable space-time, and I'll take the general case of FRW, Friedman-Robertson-Walker space-time, okay, which has a metric of this form. I have taken flat spatial slices because that's what is consistent with experimental observation. Okay, A of t is the scale factor. T here is the proper time of a co-moving observer. But for our analysis, it will be useful to also introduce a conformal time tau, which is related to t by this simple relation. Okay. And in this conformal coordinate system, we have the simple property that light rays propagate at 45 degree angle. Okay. So let's suppose that we have a co-moving object sitting at the origin. Okay. So this dotted line then denotes the world line of the co-moving object at the origin. Okay. And suppose you want to compute the probability of being hit by one of these vacuum bubbles between the time, conformal time tau and tau plus delta tau. Okay. And this probability can be calculated using the simple observation that in order for a bubble to hit us in this time, okay, the center of the bubble must be somewhere on this strip. Okay. A bubble that nucleates outside this strip either hits us too early or too late. Okay. And hence the probability of being hit by a bubble between tau and tau plus delta tau is given by this number k, which is the probability per unit 4 volume, okay, times the 4 volume of the past light cone between tau and tau plus delta tau. Okay. So that's this strip, and you have to think of this as a surface of revolution. Okay. So here is the same diagram again. Okay. Now let's denote by p of tau the survival probability of an object up to conformal time tau. Okay. So let's imagine that we have survived up to this conformal time tau. Okay. In that case, this number minus delta tau times dd tau of p tau is the reduction in p of tau in time delta tau, which means that this is the probability that will decay between this period. Okay. So this should be given by p of tau times the probability of producing a bubble somewhere in this past light cone, okay, that we have already seen is this number over here. Okay. So this is the volume of this light cone. Okay, so this is quite straightforward. The only non-trivial feature here is that you have this factor of a of sigma to the 4, and that is a reflection of the fact that the metric has the overall factor of a square multiplying it. Okay, so that the 4 volume goes as a to the 4. Okay. And from this equation, you can derive a simple differential equation for p, which is given here. Okay. As you can see here, everything can be computed explicitly except for k. For a given cosmology, a of sigma, of course, is known. Okay. So I'll call this number d of t. This is a decay rate. Okay, and we have this relation minus d dt of p is d of t times p. Okay. So let's consider the simple example of d sitter. Okay. So here is a d sitter metric, okay, which corresponds to tau being equal to minus e to the minus t. And note that we have set the Hubble constant to 1. Okay. So this d sitter, we are thinking of this as the future of our universe. Okay. And in our universe, from the known value of the cosmological constant, we know that this corresponds to setting the unit of distance or time to about 1.7 times 10 to the 10 light years or 1.7 times 10 to the 10 years. Okay. And this unit will be used throughout this talk. Okay. So unit of time will be 1.7 times 10 to the 10 years in this talk. Okay, so here is the d sitter metric again. Okay, so comparing this with the general metric that we wrote down earlier, we see that a of tau is tau inverse. Okay, and this allows us to calculate the decay rate d of t, okay, which is 4 pi k over 3. Okay, and this I'll call 1 over t. Okay, so t will be the inverse decay rate in the d sitter space time. Okay, so t is just 3 over 4 pi k. So if you could compute k, you will know what the value of t is, but of course at present, we do not know what k is. Okay. And once we have this, we can of course write down the same differential equation for p, and we can integrate it. Okay, you get the standard exponential decay of an object. Okay. And from this, we can also define a life expectancy, okay, which is the average time at which an object will decay, given that it survives up to time, say, t equal to 0. Okay, and that's given by the integral of t times the probability that it decays between t and t plus dt. Okay. And that by integration by parts is the simple result, integral p of t dt or just capital T. Now, all that I have said so far can be repeated, okay, exactly by following the same principle for FRW metric. Okay. And the FRW metric that is relevant for us is matter plus cosmological constant. Okay. And we use the current value of the matter density to dark energy density, which is 0.45. And this of course fixes A of tau completely. Okay. So we substitute A of tau and we compute the decay rate. And what we find is that the decay rate, D of t, in fact increases with time. And so here I have shown the plot of the decay rate. In fact, it's the decay rate normalized to 1 at infinity. So R of t is in fact d of t times this capital T. Okay. And the x-axis is the scale factor, A, okay, and which is normalized so that A today is 1. Okay. So you see that this is where we are today. And this shows that our decay rate is going to continue to increase, okay, till it reaches this asymptotic value, which is here. Okay. So today's decay rate, okay, turns out to be about 3.7 times the average rate in the past. Now this 3.7, this average rate in the past is important because the average decay rate in the past is what controls the probability of our survival till today. Okay. So the fact that we have survived for 14 billion years basically means that the inverse of the average decay rate in the past is in fact 14 billion years. Okay. But today's decay rate is 3.7 times larger. Okay. So the probability that I told you earlier, okay, that the probability of decaying is 1 in 10 to the 10 in the next year, okay, is in fact 3 in 10 to the 10, okay, which makes our half-life of the same order as the life of the solar system, for example. Okay. And the decay rate as t goes to infinity, that's the, when it settles down to an asymptotic de Sitter vacuum, is about 56 times larger than the average rate in the past. Okay. Now, we should also note, this is a simple calculation again, that if we didn't have a cosmological constant, the decay rate in fact would continue to grow as t cube, okay, and the decay probability will fall off as exponential minus c t to the 4 for some constant t, okay, whereas in the presence of cosmological constant we have seen that the probability falls off as e to the minus t over capital T, okay. And so you see from this that a metastable universe with cosmological constant is a far safer place to live than one without. Okay, now what we have described so far is somewhat inevitable, okay. This is something that is beyond our control, okay. But now we want to address whether we can do something to improve the situation. And the strategy is to spread out in space and then let the Hubble expansion pull the different settlements outside each other's horizon, okay, so that a single bubble may not be able to destroy all the settlements, okay. And this is the diagrammatic description of this, okay. So tau here is again the conformal time, x is space direction. So suppose we are here today, okay, that's tau equal to minus 1 or t equal to 0, okay, and we slowly send out our different people in different parts of space, okay. These are all time like trajectories, less than 45 degree angle to the vertical, so it's very much possible to have these trajectories, okay, and then let them settle down to different co-moving distances and evolve in time. And as you can see now that if a bubble forms here, okay, it's going to destroy one of these but not all of them. So some of the settlements will live on while others die, okay, and this means that this will increase our collective life expectancy, which we define as the average time at which the last settlement undergoes vacuum decay. Okay, so now let's try to do some concrete calculations. So let's suppose we take two co-moving objects in De Sitter space separated by some distance r, okay. And let's assume that they both exist at t equal to 0, okay. This is our 0 of time, this is where we begin, okay. Now suppose p1 of t and p2 of t are the survival probability of objects 1 and 2 till time t, and p1 2 t1 t2 is the joint survival probability of the first object till time t1 and the second object till time t2, okay. Then the probability that at least one survives till time t is given by this combination over here. So you basically add up the probabilities of survival of the first object till time t and the second object till time t, but you have to subtract from this the overcounting that you have done, because both objects may survive till time t, that would have been counted twice in this, okay. So you subtract this off, okay. And given this quantity we can then compute the collective life expectancy, okay. So the probability that the last object decays between t and t plus dt is just minus d dt of this times dt, so that's this combination over here, okay. We multiply it by t and then integrate, okay, and then we can do a simple integration by parts to arrive at this formula for the collective life expectancy of the two objects, okay. So this is the formula again, okay. Now first let's make a very simple minded approximation. Let's suppose that the decays are independent, okay. If the decays had been independent, then we will have p1 and p2 going as e to the minus t over t, this we have seen earlier, and the joint survival probability is just given by the product of the two probabilities, so p1 p2, which is e to the minus 2 t over t, okay. We can substitute this in this expression and integrate, okay, and we get a collective life expectancy of the order 3 half times t, okay. So we increase the life expectancy by a factor by 50% by making two copies, okay. And we can easily see by a simple calculation that if you have n objects which undergo independent decay, then the collective life expectancy increases by a factor of the nth harmonic number. But in practice, the decays are not independent, okay, and we have to do more detailed study, okay. So let's go back to our definition of p12 again. So p12 t1 t2 as the joint probability that the first object survives till time t1 and the second object survives till time t2, okay. So from this we can see that the joint probability that the first object decays between t1 and t1 plus dt1 and the second object survives till t2, okay, this is given by simply the change in this as you change t1 from t1 to t1 plus dt1. Okay, because during that time p1 to changes because the first object would have decayed. There is a certain probability that the first object would decay. Okay. So minus dt1 times the LLT1 of this is this joint probability. Okay, so this is what I have written again. So this combination is the probability that the first object decays between t1 and t1 plus dt1, and the second job or second object survives till t2. But of course, we know how to calculate this in de Sitter space. Okay, now you are assuming that you have settled down to de Sitter, but you could have easily repeated this if including the full FRW metric. Okay. So in de Sitter space, this will be given by P12 times K times the volume of the past light cone of 1 between tau 1 and tau 1 plus zeta 1. Okay, so this is the same diagram again. Okay. But now there is an added twist, because from this past light cone, you have to exclude the past light cone of the observer 2 of the object 2 at time t2, because you have already assumed this is a prior that the observer 2 survives till time t2. Okay, that is the probability we are trying to calculate. So we know already that there is no vacuum bubble produced in the past light cone of observer 2, so you exclude this. Okay, and we integrate to compute the volume of this strip. Okay, and this of course is a simple geometric problem that you can solve, and you can compute this volume. So then the steps that one follows is that we calculate this derivative of P1 with respect to T1 by calculating the volume of this cell that I showed you in the last slide. Okay. Then we integrate this. Okay. But this integration is done with the boundary condition that if we set T1 equal to 0, okay, that's the initial time. Okay. And our prior is that at T1 equal to 0, both objects exist. Okay. So at T1 equal to 0, the first object definitely exists. Okay. Second object, because the second argument is t2, okay, the probability that the second object survives till t2 is just given by p2 of t2. Okay. So this then, this integral determines p12 of t1 t2 in terms of p2 of t2. Okay. We can similarly calculate p1 of t1 and p2 of t2 individually by setting up appropriate differential equations for these objects. Okay. And from this we can calculate the collective life expectancy by the same combination again. Okay. Once you have computed P1 and P2, from this you calculate P12 of T1 T2 by integrating this differential equation, then we substitute it here to compute the collective life expectancy. Okay. And here is the result that we get. Okay. So this result, what it shows on the y-axis is what we call the gain. Okay. So gain is the ratio of the collective life expectancy of two objects to that of a single object. Okay. And along the x-axis, I have plotted the unknown parameter k, or equivalently t. Okay. So the x-axis actually labels t, which is the same as the the inverse of k up to some factors of 3 over 4 pi. Okay. And these different curves, okay, over here correspond to different initial separation. Okay, so these are the different values of r. R was the separation between the two objects. So you go from r equal to 0.0003 to r equal to 0.3. Okay, and I'll describe in the next slide what these means physically. Okay, so here is the same diagram again. Okay, so if we recall that our unit of time or distance is 1.7 times 10 to the 10 years or light years. Okay. Then r equal to 0.0003, which is this curve over here, okay, this is the lowest one, okay, corresponds to a separation about 5 million light years. Okay. And the reason that I have chosen this, we have chosen this as the lowest value of r, is because 5 million light years in fact is the minimum distance that is needed to escape the gravitational binding to the local cluster. Okay. It doesn't help to separate at a distance that is less than 5 million light years, because we will simply be gravitationally bound to the same system forever. Okay, the Hubble expansion will not separate us. Okay, so we need a minimum distance. Okay, and that's 5 million light years. And what we see from here is that even for this minimum separation, okay, if for example our decay rate was 1% of the expansion rate, which corresponds to t equal to 100, okay, we basically achieve a gain which is almost the maximum gain. Okay. In fact, the maximum gain is 1.5 that you have already seen. having two objects with completely independent decay probability, we gain a factor by a factor of 3/2, right? That's 1.5. So you cannot do better than 1.5, okay? And what we see from this diagram is that we go close to 1.5, okay, even with the minimum separation, 5 million light years, okay, if the decay rate is 100 times the expansion rate. If on the other hand, the decay rate is say 10% of the expansion rate, that's t equal to 10, we still gain by a factor of 20%. Thank you. So this is basically the end of the technical part of the talk. So let me just finish with some general lessons. So I'll begin by this general lesson by giving a quote from Coleman. Okay, in fact, Nima quoted from Coleman in the morning. Okay, this is a quote in a different context, okay, which says that the possibility that we are living in a false vacuum has never been a cheering one to contemplate. Okay, this is from Coleman de Lucia. Okay. But what we have seen in this talk is that if we are destined to live in a false vacuum, we are far safer in a vacuum with cosmological constant than in one without it. Okay. First of all, the cosmological constant tames the growth of the decay rate from t cubed to a constant. Okay, this is without us doing anything. Okay. But we also have seen that it gives us an opportunity to fight back and increase our collective life expectancy by spreading out. Okay, and this is simply because the Hubble expansion can separate us so that a single vacuum may not be able to destroy all the civilizations at once. Okay, and this is impossible if the final vacuum had been Minkowski. And finally, I'll end by again emphasizing the role of string theory. Okay. So it's clear from this that it's important to know what this number t is. Okay. T is the decay rate in the final de Sitter universe. Okay. For example, if t happens to be 10 to the 20 years, okay, then we shouldn't care about all this. Okay. We'll die anyway because of the end of the galaxies, okay, before we undergo vacuum decay. Okay. So you don't have to worry about this if t turns out to be of the order of 10 to the 20 years. Okay. So it's important to know what t is, okay, if we want to decide whether to adopt this strategy or not. Okay. And it turns out that the computation of this t, or equivalent in the number k, is a highly UV sensitive quantity. Okay. It's impossible, almost impossible to say anything about this from a bottom up approach. Okay. And the reason is that given a perfectly sensible theory, okay, which has a perfectly stable vacuum, you could simply add a scalar field which has a very high heavy mass, okay, but with the wrong kind of potential, and you could get a vacuum with an arbitrarily large decay rate. Okay. So it's by knowing low energy physics, it's almost impossible to determine t. Okay. And of course, you wouldn't want to determine it by doing a direct experiment. Okay. So the only hope is to find a top-down approach, which is string theory. Okay. String theory, being a microscopic theory, has the possibility of calculating this number. Okay. And for this, you have to either find our position in the landscape, okay, or we have to develop a statistical argument which shows that for a vast majority of the vacua that resemble ours, t lies within a narrow range. Okay. And then you can take that t as the most likely value of t that we have. Now, there have been some attempts to develop a statistical argument by these authors, but it's probably fair to say that we do not yet have robust results on this, based on which we can make our survival plans. So it's clearly not going to be an easy task, but given that it has so much effect on the plans for our survival, it will certainly be worth making the effort. Thank you very much.
You mentioned it's safer to live in a universe with cosmological constant than without. Could that be inverted to explain why we live in such a universe?
Well, maybe it, I don't know. Yeah. But the point is, if our universe had been supersymmetric, then of course there is no decay, right? So it will be perfectly safe to live in a supersymmetric universe.
No, I'm not saying you have a choice. I'm saying the fact that we are in a non-supersymmetric one, but with a cosmological constant, can that be safe?
Yeah, probably, okay. The point is, given a universe with cosmological constant around out, and if they have the same decay rate, same k, okay, then certainly it's much more likely that we are living in a universe with cosmological constant, because the ones without would have decayed much faster.
But does the numerics work out? Is there some numerics that can support it? Or
not? Yeah, I don't know.
Other questions, comments? Sorry, regarding Cameron's question, I can't help noting that this would be like an anthropic principle for future generations. It's like going beyond the usual argument.
Yeah, maybe.
It would be part of that thinking, but for decades.
Mangesh.
There is a possibility of multiple bubbles forming as well, right?
Yes.
So how does that affect the collective survival?
Yeah, so that of course has been already taken into account in this calculation, right? It's because of the multiple bubbles, okay? The result that we got, see here you are of course counting, let me do, okay. So this calculation, okay, allows for the formation of multiple bubbles, right? So that has been taken into account. It's precisely because of multiple bubbles that the result here is not just 1.5, right? The probability, if there is no multiple bubble formation, then the probability should have been independent, right? You will always get 1.5. It's the multiple bubbles which make this not 1.5, but as you can see, that as t becomes larger, okay, the probability of forming multiple bubbles becomes smaller, okay, and you approach the result that is 1.5.
Any more questions? Okay, so I'm sure you're all aware that in Bangalore, the probability of being run over while crossing a street is 1. So please be more careful about that. Let's thank Ashok for a very stimulating talk. I think we now break for lunch. Do the organizers have any announcements? No? Will we find lunch where we had tea? Okay.